meant to be. So if that's on your agenda, please register. You can register online at our website, and that is under the Spiritual Toolkit. Again, class starts tomorrow, and if you register and are already registered, please see Reverend Margie after church. She's got a book for you. If you're not going to, if you're not registered but are going to go home right after this and register, please see Reverend Margie. She has a book for you. Okay? How many people are going to go sign up for this right now after? Oh, I got a hand in the audience. Thank you. I got two. I could be, I got three going once, going twice. I could have, it could happen right here. Okay. We also have another amazing class that's happening right now. It's on Saturdays with Joanne Lewis West. It's called The Process of Prayer. She is an amazing teacher. She's also written a book on prayer. It's every Saturday from 10 a.m. to noon. That's in the garden room. That's right down the stairs across the entryway. And that class is free. There's no registration. Anybody can come, and it's going to be going on through February 24th. So avail yourself to a little prayer and process with Joanne Lewis. Who's got gloves? I want to see some hands. Who's got some garden gloves in this sanctuary? You two at home, I'm watching you. Garden gloves, any kind of gloves, rubber gloves. I want to see hands. There's no hands. Does anybody not own a pair of gloves? I've got somebody who's got a pair of gloves. There's somebody else. There's somebody else. We've got gloves. Well, bring your gloves next Saturday because we're going to have a little cleanup here on campus. It's campus cleanup day, and we want you to don some gloves so you can get dirty and get down with it so we can clean our campus. That's going to be from 9 to noon next Saturday, January 27th. So bring your gloves. Now, if you're like, I don't have any gloves, that's okay. You're still invited. All right. So come and join us next Saturday to clean up our campus. That's, again, from 9 till noon. All right. So one more thing. Reverend Tim is gone. I don't know if you know this, but Reverend Tim is on the mainland hanging out with his mom. Like, how wonderful is that he gets to be gone and hang out with his mom? So special. So we're saying hey to him. We know that he's doing well as his mother. He's going to be gone for a couple of weeks. And in the meantime, we have amazing speakers lined up. And every Wednesday, Reverend Tim does a class called The Deeper Dive. It's on our e-campus. We want you to know that that class is still going to be going on, and it's going to be filled by the speaker of the day. So, for example, today is our speaker is Leslee Ellenson. I'm going to be sharing a little bit about her in a moment. She's going to be on The Deeper Dive with you this Wednesday. That's at 5 o'clock at e-campus. So if you've never done a deeper dive, it's what it means. It takes you a deeper dive into the spiritual message that was given today. So please avail yourself to that. And finally, I'm your treasurer. I'm on the board. I have a little sticker right here that says I'm on the board. And we have this wonderful opportunity. We have staff. We have a mighty, small, but mighty staff. And they work really hard behind the scenes. Most of us don't even know the work that they do to keep this all going, from the TVs behind us to the sound to all the things, right? And this is an opportunity for us to say thank you to our mighty staff. So in front of you, in the chair in front of you, is a little envelope. And if you don't see it, check a couple chairs down. If you feel like providing a little extra something, something to our great mighty staff, we are looking for our staff to have a bonus. And we are just going to continue to ask for that for the next couple weeks. And thank you for your generous giving. All right. I know you're going to miss me, but announcements are about to be over. However, before they are, I want to take this opportunity to introduce our guest speaker today. She is the absolute beautiful and stunning beloved Leslee Ellenson. Please stand, Leslee. Leslee is a, yes, she is a ministerial candidate. Leslee is a licensed Unity teacher. Leslee is a prayer chaplain. Leslee is truly a woman of God. We are so grateful to have her here. And Leslee is going to be ordained this coming June at Unity Village. So we're so excited to have her as our speaker today, and you'll get to hear from her shortly. But first, let's get started with our worship portion of our service. Thank you.
Standing outside the door of love and mercy, you wonder if there's a place here for you.
You know there's peace inside, but still you're searching for someone who understands the pain you've been through.
Well, the Spirit waits with open arms, that's calling out your name.
Come on in, welcome home. You are loved and you belong here now. No
You'll find a place of rest in the arms of Spirit. We've waited so long for your homecoming day.
God knows the peace you need and the hurt you're feeling. Spirit wants to hold you and to wipe your tears away.
Well, the door's unlocked, the lights are on. What are you waiting for? Come on in, welcome home. You are loved and you belong here now. No matter where you've been,
come on in,
come on in.
Welcome home here in the sanctuary as we prepare for our worship service. And Jesus reminds us in Matthew 5:44 that there is a higher calling. And in times such as these, it rings true that it is one thing. It's very easy to love our neighbors, the ones that are good to us. But the higher calling is to love the unlovables, the ones that show up pretty difficult at times. And so let us say a statement of truth, an affirmation that will carry us through this week with today's message from Leslee Ellenson. Together, I show up as my highest self. Together, I show up as my highest self. I learn to love the unlovables. I learn to love the unlovables by first loving myself. By first loving myself. And so it is.
Is. And we wanted to continue our service this morning by doing our mission statement together. Would you join me in that?
Yes.
Centered in God.
Centered in God.
We are transforming lives.
We are transforming lives.
And inspiring people.
And inspiring people.
To make a positive difference.
To make a positive difference.
In our world.
In our world.
And let's make a positive difference by standing as you are able and singing in the sanctuary.
Praise, amen.
I feel it today. Thank you so much. Oh my gosh. Here at Unity, we believe there is only one presence and one power active in the universe and in our lives, the living, loving presence of God. Do you feel it?
Yes.
That is the greatest thing. Join us in singing the greatest thing.
Thing in all my life is knowing you. The greatest thing in all my life is knowing you.
Absolutely beautiful. Oh, friends, today's inspirational reading comes from the book, The Inner Work, An Invitation to True Freedom and Lasting Happiness. And this was written by Matthew Micheletti and Ashley Cottrell. And the reading begins. Unconditional love is only realized by letting go of the mind's attachment to hierarchies of dualities. This versus that. Lovable versus unlovable, happiness versus suffering, positive versus negative, life versus death, best versus worst. Attachment to preferences will always place conditions on love and keep it limited due to the perception of a hierarchy between two opposing polarities. So, friends, as long as something could be better than this, the ego will always be able to create suffering through the resistance of what is, free of all preference of opinion. In order to be free from the bondage of dualities, we have to see that it is one non-duality. In order to be free from the bondage of duality, we have to see that it is one non-duality. Everything in existence is all divinity. It is all the same one. The ego just creates the illusion of separation because of its preferences to attachments. Thus, It is not that we develop the ability to love the unlovable. It is simply that we let go of the notion of unlovability in the first place. Let's just do that last line again. It is simply that we let go of the notion of unlovability in the first place. Friends, this is a time in our service where we get to take a deeper dive into the process of prayer, one of our spiritual practices here. And we begin today for a prayer for the self. So if it suits you, you can lower your eyes, or perhaps you want to keep your gaze up today and look at the people who are sitting next to you. I know I do. And what I know that I know that I know is that there is just one heart and one mind and one life. It's the heart, the mind, the life of the divine. And right here in this now moment, I'm calling it love. I'm calling it good. I'm calling it God. And Spirit, what I know is that you, Spirit, you wrap yourselves around me this day and every day. I know that as I know that for myself, I know that for each and every person in this sanctuary. I know that I see the light of God, Spirit, in front of me this day. And I know that there is an invitation that when we look in the mirror of life, each and every morning after we wake up, that when we look in the mirror of life, we see you, Spirit. We see you looking back at us because we are the beloved community. We are the loved ones. We are the lovable. That there is no space where God is not, and there is no space where love is not. So in this day and in this way, Spirit, we just say thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your light. Thank you for this energy, this synergy, this glorious good day that we call today. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
In His time, in His time.
We continue in this presence of a greater truth, knowing that as we gather intentionality into this space that we call prayer, we are claiming the promise in Scripture and other wisdom literature that says when we tune our mind and our energy to God, to the source, to the divine, that energy is magnified, and we claim that right here, right now, in this holy and sacred time and space. As we gather in prayer for our community. If you're holding a bulletin in your hand or you've got a digital format, in the center there is a list of people who have been asked to be held in prayer for whatever the need is that's in their life in this moment. Maybe in their life it's healing physically, mentally, emotionally. Maybe it's a flowing energy of abundance in life. Maybe it's wisdom and guidance and direction from a source outside the ego that we all have access to. We pray for this community and hold it in the greater truth that we are called into a greater service, that we are here doing the work that helps each of us transform our lives into what the divine has called us to live. We are here to inspire one another to make a difference in our amazing world, to bring the amazing truth of love into this experience by every thought and action. Whatever community you may be a part of, whether it's your family of birth, the family of your heart that you have created, your workplace, your social groups, we hold all of that interconnection in the light of God, knowing that we are here to serve the purpose of love always and in all ways. And so it is. Thank you, God.
In your time, in your time, you make all things beautiful. In your time, Lord, my life to you I bring. May each song I have to sing be to you a lovely thing. In your time.
Now let us deepen our expression and bring in the global consciousness and calling on that ever-abiding presence of God, that no matter what shows up in this world, whether it's the heat or extreme cold, the war or the famine, God, we know that you are present in each experience. We know that you can make a way when there is no way. All crooked places made straight when we lean on you and you alone. And as a collective consciousness right here, right now, in this community, we are calling on your peace, your grace, your ease, your joy, your comfort. In all global affairs, we lift them to you and leave them at the altar. And we give thanks in advance that you know what you're doing. We say, thank you, God. And so it is, it can be no other way. Amen and amen.
Morning. Lovely to see all your smiling faces today. Would help if I opened my notes. How do we love the unlovables? How do we love people we deem unlovable? How do we love? Period. How do we love? Yeah, it's good questions. How? As a very young girl, I had a lesson in being lovable and then being unlovable. And let me explain. I grew up out in Bayport, Long Island, New York. That's between Patchogue and Sayville. It's still there on the map. You can look it up on Google Maps. And I lived with my parents in an A-frame home on a quarter acre of lot. And I had a dog, a bicycle, an Annie Oakley cap gun to shoot the boys with, you know. And at the end of the street was something called Camp Edie. It was woods. It's still there. I was shocked. The cul-de-sac has been developed, but the whole area is now homes, but they preserve the heart of Camp Edie. Now, as a kid, I had everything I thought a person needed. Loving parents, pet, you know, that bicycle, the woods, the friends. And I had a fun-loving father. He was so fun-loving that any knock at the front door was kids asking not me out to play, literally, but could Mickey come out and play? Because he had all these cool hobbies. He rode horses, he shot guns, he flew airplanes, he had a CB radio in the basement, he had a ham radio. There was always people in our basement listening to ham signals and ham radios and talking. It was a blast. Dad was amazing. Mom, quiet, scholarly, a little bit agoraphobic, she would sit and read, expect me to read, and let me stay up late at night to watch TV with her, especially The Twilight Zone. That was my first introduction to metaphysics. And I still won't sleep with my bed pushed against the wall. If you know, you know. So my parents decided they needed to be a two-income household. What did that mean to me? Well, it meant my mother was going to apprentice to the Printers Union, Typographical 6, in New York City, and she had to apprentice for 3 years at night, overnight. I was like third grade. Guess what? I got shipped out to my grandparents, and my aunt and uncle also lived in that house. The only thing that made it bearable, there were three French poodles to console me. But the household was tough. It was rules, regulations, expectations, frowning a lot, criticism, and no hugs. I missed my father's easygoing spirit. I missed people knocking on the door. They still didn't knock on the door for me, but they sure didn't knock on the door for my grandparents either. It was the kind of environment where you're always scared you do the wrong thing. So I had gone from being mindlessly aware that I was lovable to somehow being unlovable and having only conditional acceptance. So I went on a quest all through my life to answer this question. Well, you know, how do you go from a lovable to an unlovable? And who's an unlovable anyway? And why did I feel unlovable after that experience for most of my life? Maybe you have someone like that in your life. Maybe you have people who you call an unlovable. Once I had developed all the values and standards and all that criticism went into me from my grandparents, I grew up not even aware. I had sucked it all in and it became who I am. It happens, right? You don't even know. It's part of you. So fast forward, here I am in this day and age. I have a fiance who has a large family and also a large ohana here. And hidden away in the ohana is a young man who pushes my buttons. Maybe they push your buttons out there. He never got a good education, sinful in my family. He never held down a job for more than a couple of months. His address was either the street or someone's couch. And he says things like, and I really heard this, the family needs to get its act together and give me a living. Really? Unworthy much? Unlovable much? To force myself to be nice to him, I lent him, $1,300 10 years ago. Haven't seen a penny of it yet. Never a borrower or a lender be. Now it becomes a real challenge to love the unlovables in our life. And I ask you while I'm speaking to consider who pushes your buttons and who do you think is an unlovable. And maybe you're being nice and you don't want to classify anybody as that, but it becomes a real challenge to love the unlovable when you're thinking of the criminally insane, rapists, serial killers, drug dealers, human traffickers, and the list goes on and on and on. But why are we all so judgmental all of the time? Why is our human default mode to criticize and condemn both ourselves and others? Well, traditional Christianity, which Unity is not, says it is because humanity fell from grace and we lost our spark of divinity. Nonsense. In Unity, we know and affirm that we were born into a state of perfect grace and perfection. We are the divine spark of God incarnate in the here and now. In short, we are lovable. And yet, we regularly criticize, fault find, and condemn. Why? Albert Einstein once wrote, You cannot solve a problem with the same mind that created it. And that's what we're talking about today. How do you solve this kind of a problem? So where does all this error thinking and judgment in our minds come from? We have learned it, just like I learned it from my grandparents. We have all literally been taught this kind of error thinking. TV and multimedia have replaced religion as the opiate of the people, says Karl Marx. Neuroscientist Dr. Jeffrey Fannin says 75% of all human thoughts are negative. 75%? The human amygdala can begin to perceive everything as a threat. It's fight and flight, and that fits everything we see in TV, movies, and books, because the basis of the story we tell each other is conflict. Good and bad, up and down, left and right. Everything is the duality of being here in this plane of existence. We look for it. Ah, that story didn't have enough conflict. Why was the movie boring? Well, the characters never really changed and they never grew. I didn't see their conflict. Word conflict is a major word in our existence. And it becomes me against you and us against them. Now, neuroscientists and spiritual texts have discovered a process by which we program the subconscious mind. Here's the things that go into the subconscious mind that really create who we are: our experiences, our beliefs, our interpretations of all of that, our perceptions, and that all leads to the behaviors, and that's how we act out. Experiences, beliefs, interpretations, perceptions, and the resulting behavior. Scientist Rob Williams, who runs a project called Psych-K, says we can reprogram the subconscious. Remember, the body takes instructions from the subconscious mind. Now ponder this statement, because it holds the key to perfect health. Thought goes from the subconscious to the body to the cells. Your health is dependent on what you have already stored up in your subconscious. Remember, subconscious, you're not always aware of what's in there. It's like a file drawer you threw your whole life into and you're not sure when it's going to show up. Nikola Tesla, the electrical and chemical engineer, futurist, said, if you want to find the secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy, that's God, energy, vibration, and the frequency you dial up. So we need to learn how to change our frequency, but be aware of something crucial to know. The conscious mind speed has been clocked at 40 bits per second. Now that part of your conscious mind is in the cerebral cortex. It's up here. The subconscious mind speed is 40 million bits per second. It's back here in the basal ganglia, the reptilian brain, sometimes called the basement of the brain. It is the first part of the triune brain that ever evolved. It's our basic nature. This is where your perceptions are stored and your behaviors follow. And we often say that the adverse ego and the subconscious are what's in control of you, and they're pretty much the same thing. I created a way of visualizing the human condition which allows us to see it more objectively rather than from inside. Here's an image you can externalize. I find that interesting for me. Imagine that for a moment you're seated for meditation, or just seated before a full-length mirror. And you see a reflection looking back at you, and we're going to label what you see. And we're using computer terminology for this because it works. Coming down into the crown chakra, picture a golden light coming in. That's your indwelling source code. It's your God. The brain, the gray matter, also the body. That's your hardware or your hard drive. The mind, all the programs, the family beliefs, your shadow selves, your life experiences, everything you've learned basically is some form of a software. It's an application, you've learned it. Every class you go to, you open a file in your brain, download that information, okay? Now this hardware and this software become your personality or your adverse ego. and your adverse ego runs you, just like a computer where it's acting as the overall operating system. And it is a perpetual battle in our lives between that operating system and trying to listen to the divine incoming source code. This information isn't even new. The Egyptians knew it. They called the divine spark your Ka, K-A, and your personality your Ba, B-A. They understood the dualistic nature of man, and we're all just trying to conquer it today. Now, the adverse ego is sneaky, sneaky little guy. It goes into the subconscious and plants the programming wherever we want to deem someone unlovable. It keeps it in there, too. It's running a software program in the background. So in other words, our own beliefs and opinions are actually being hidden from our conscious selves. Why do we even have an adverse ego? I love this question, the one I came upon it inside myself. Why? Why do we have one? Ironically, I realized it was divinely created for us in order for us to exist in this third density of space and time. The ego is called the adverse ego because its only job is to keep us alive, physically safe, and tightly tethered to life in this third density. It doesn't want us to remember that the atonement is eternally present in us. Even though we have our faulty perceptions, it's right there, that atonement. It never went away. It's nothing to achieve. It's just wake up and go, oh yeah, it's always been inside me. The resurrection we talk about can be defined as the awareness of the atonement of our eternal divinity. So what is true, right? Be aware that all attacks are by and from that adverse ego. Impurity of that thought must be living in me in order for me to judge myself or another person. So why do we deem someone unlovable? Well, it's a sign of our own impure thoughts. I'm thinking that. There is a lot of metaphysical wisdom in the short Bible verse, Matthew 7:1. Judge not, lest you be judged. Okay, yeah. Who is judging us? Well, we are judging ourselves when we dare to judge another person. That story in Matthew is actually about hypocrisy. Who are we to ever judge, even ourselves? Our true life purpose is to see each and every person as totally guiltless, as perfect, as pure and holy children of God. Fortunately, you and I do not have the power to cast anyone out of the love of God. Thank goodness. So why don't we just bypass that adverse ego? Why can't we just go and sit in a cave and meditate like people did in years past? Well, no. In Unity, we highly encourage everyone to work on their emotional, mental, and spiritual maturity, such as taking the Quantum Living course and working on your shadow self. But why? Here's a reason that I came up with that I never even thought of before. It is to mature, but also to placate the adverse ego, placate that adverse ego into feeling secure enough and trusting you enough to allow your higher self to embark on your spiritual journey. The first day you say, I'm going to be spiritual, and I think I'll sit down and I'm going to meditate, and this is such good stuff, the adverse ego starts to experience separation anxiety, and you're like, no, I know I can do this, and the ego goes, no, you can't, no, you can't. Mm-mm. You're not going to let you do it. At first, the ego will take over that spiritual journey and will begin to control it, but you won't really realize it, but it'll fake you out. You'll sit there and you'll go to meditate and you're like, I'm doing it. And you realize you're writing your shopping list or you're worried about that birthday card you never sent. 100 million things come in and take your mind away from meditation. And you say, I just can't focus my mind. No, not really. The adverse ego doesn't want you to. So who's the boss? It's a real question in life. So how do we program the subconscious to quiet down that adverse ego? Another how. How do we bet ourselves and to be more loving and kind? There are some very practical steps I came upon, and we all do a lot of these. Some people do all of them. Some have just started. I've got 11, so bear with me. You can change your environment, which stirs things up. You can reduce your screen time. You can read more, study, spiritual study. Spend time with positive spiritual people like you are today, being here or online. You can consciously watch your thoughts. Literally watch. Look at your thoughts. Who is doing the thinking? Do you think it's your conscious self in the moment? Or did something come up and you don't know where it came from, but you're thinking it, but it was your subconscious? Got to look out for that little thing, that subconscious. Call out your negative thoughts. If 75% of our thoughts are negative, catch them. Oh, I don't feel good. Oh, this hurts. Oh, I can't believe it's morning. Why don't I have something better for breakfast? I don't want to talk to her. Everything is a negative thought. Do you wake up and go, thank you, God, for another day. I'm going to write a page and a half in my gratitude journal. If you are, you're giving the sermon next week. We've got denials and affirmations. In Unity, we teach you need to make a vacuum with the denial and fill it with an affirmation. You can't just do affirmations. Where do you put them? You got to lose it to fill it. Prayer, of course. Deep breathing or pranayama. Our beloved Sue Choi here, expert in breathing practices. Visualizations, whether they're guided or you make them up, are good to lead you into the most important thing, meditation. Understand that as you do all of these things, you're writing new programs that are going into your subconscious for you to draw upon. And the more you put all of these 11 things as experiences into your life, that becomes the newest programming that you're going to be running that subconscious on. Again, it's experiences, beliefs, interpretations, perceptions, and behaviors. But let's circle back to how do we love the unlovable? Well, it's by reprogramming our subconscious mind. In Unity, we believe everyone lives in you and we all live in God. I love that phrase. Everyone lives in you and we all live in God. 1 John 4:21 is a commandment, and it says, the command, or talks about a commandment. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Ah, gee, there it goes again, right? What does this verse mean to us in Unity? Well, it speaks to the Unity first principle. One power, one presence, one God, divine, always loving. And then there's a Unity second principle. We are what God is. We are manifestations of God. We are called to be the love of God in manifestation here. A Course in Miracles speaks totally about, with all those huge number of words in that huge book, showing up as the love of God. That's our task. Show up as the love of God. Do you ever really think of yourself as the love of God in manifestation? Does that feel a little awkward sometimes? Really? I just me. No. You are the love of God in manifestation. Whoa. Charles Fillmore, co-founder of the Unity Movement in the Revealing Word, said, love is the pure essence of being that binds together the whole human family. TruthUnity.net back in the 1940s had a question and answer going on. And somebody wanted to talk about that 1 John 4:21 verse. And they wrote, why can't we love God without having to love our brothers and sisters? And the answer was brilliant. Because God is in our brother, and until we can see God in manifest form in another, until we can see that, we cannot see or perceive the absolute good, which is God as principle. We are here to practice loving one another, to basically make ourselves capable of really loving and communing with God. Mother Teresa was asked how she dealt with the extreme filth and poverty of the people she served in Calcutta, India. And she said, I look in their eyes and I see the beloved. I see the Christ within. Look at each other from today forward if you haven't already been doing it. And no matter what you want to judge the person, but I don't like what she's wearing. Why did they do that? You know, all the stuff we naturally do, and we do this stuff. Look into the eyes and say, I see the beloved. Does it really matter what they're wearing, what they said? You know, drop all of that. Tell the subconscious, take a back seat on this. I'm coming forward, and I choose, affirmatively choose, to only see the beloved. Kurt Stuckmeyer, in his book, An Unorthodox Faith, highly recommend this book, gives the best list of the character qualities of Jesus I have ever seen. I invite you to close your eyes and just think on these. Radical love, lavish generosity, extravagant forgiveness, inclusive hospitality, compassionate action, selfless service, a passion for justice, creative nonviolence, and just simple living. I got a lesson last year on how to love the unlovables. I wrote it down on my calendar. It was December 27th, 2022. I wrote it down in my calendar, and I honestly wrote down the God moment day. I was in Waikai Town Center, minding my own business. It was after Christmas. Minding my own business, and I go past a bench, and a gentleman in a hoodie is sitting there. He's not moving, not doing anything. I think nothing of it. I'm walking by, and I hear a whisper. I'm not even sure I heard it. I heard a whisper, and it was, help, help, help. But it was a whisper, help. You know, and you tend to respond if somebody says help. And I looked, and he's still sitting there. No eye contact, no moving, just sitting. And I'm like, well, this is strange. What's with him? So I walk away, and I think about it, and I'm like, oh, gosh, you know, who is this guy? I've never seen him before. I can't even see his face. You know, is he houseless? Is he part of the neighborhood? What do I do? And I'm trying to judge. And I'm like, well, he said help, I think. And I'm thinking, oh, God, I just went to the bank machine. I only have $20 bills on me. I'm going to give $20 to a stranger, and I'm having an argument in my head like a fool. So I palm a $20 bill, and I walk back thinking, maybe he's gone, right? Maybe he's gone. He's not gone. He's still sitting there. I'm like, oh, good grief. So I just walk up, and you know, I can't even see his face. And I go, excuse me, maybe this will help, because you use that word. He doesn't say anything at first. And I'm like, okay. And I want to walk away, but I'm feeling an energy that I can't even begin to describe beaming off of him. And I'm like, something's happening here. What is this? And after about, I don't know, 20, 30 seconds, it was long enough to feel like I didn't know what to do. He doesn't even look up. He simply says, I love you. And I burst into tears. I did. It was such a pure energy, just nothing attached to it. No judgments, no expectations, no other words, no eye contact, just, I love you. So simple. I walked away. I was crying. I was embarrassed. I ran to the Starbucks. I got myself a Starbucks. Now I'm talking to myself again like I was in the beginning. Who was that? Who did I give money to? Oh, my gosh. Who does he think he is? Help. Well, okay. I mean, you know, charity is important. But who is this guy? And I wanted to knock him down a step. So I'm running down the sidewalk with my iced tea, and he's nowhere to be found. The bench is empty. I check all the restaurants because I know the shopping center by heart. Nope, he's not there. I run around the back. Maybe he's taking a nap in the bushes in the back. Nope. I look at the bus stop. No. And then I stop and think, better that I don't find him. There's a beautiful saying, it comes out of Judaism, many have entertained Elijah and never known it. Passover, he always set a place for Elijah. And maybe it was the Christ, maybe it was Buddha. Then I got egotistical. Oh, I'm in seminary, so it must have been a spiritual test. Did I pass? No. Did I pass? I have been wondering that ever since. But the beauty of that energy from him, just so simple, just, I love you. Can we just do that with everyone we meet? Can we just look into the eyes and say, I see the beloved in you. You are the beloved, and I am the beloved looking back at the beloved. Can we just do that? So I will spend the rest of my life hoping to have more God moments. God wink moments, if you're into Hallmark, a God wink moment. And I'll spend the rest of my life looking for that angel, that Elijah, that Jesus, that Buddha. And you know where I'm going to find it? I'm going to find it in you, and in you, and in you, and in you, and in you. And so it is. Amen. Thank you. And now taking this spirit, this knowledge, this love in your heart, and blessing both your lovables and your identified unlovables, we take them into the deep inner space within us, where that love and that Christ consciousness, the divinity, our divine source code, is always present. And we go inside and we just take a deep breath in, and we give thanks humbly as we go into the silence and acknowledge our absolute divinity. And as we quickly come out of our meditation, we know that we are the divine in manifestation. And I thank you for coming forth today as your best self, your Christ self. Amen.
Father, Mother, birther and breath of all, create a space inside us and fill it with your presence. Let oneness now prevail. Age to age, from you flows the glorious harmonies of life. May these statements be fertile ground from which our future grows. Amen. Amen.
It's yours. It's yours, all yours, all yours. The kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours, forever. Your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive the ones who sinned against us. Forgive them, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. Father, let your kingdom come.
Holy, holy.
Father, let your will be done.
Holy, holy.
On earth as in heaven.
Will be done.
Right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come.
Holy, holy.
Father, let your will be done. yours, all yours, all yours, forever and ever. The kingdom is yours. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will as we forgive the ones who sinned against us. Forgive them and leave us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as
music team. I don't know what happened to this mic. Leslee, can I have, are you hearing me? It, thank you. I'm not hearing me. Then I'll let that go. I want to say welcome, ekoma mai, to everyone who is here for the first time or anyone returning after a very long time. We are glad you are here today. I see many of you have already received a kukui natle if this is your first guest. Our ushers are here. If you would like to receive your kukui natle on your first visit, we invite you to raise your hand if you haven't yet received it. It's the gift we share with you. Kukui nuts here in the island represent light, hope, a sense of renewal. Especially, they represent the light that you are. And Leslee, thank you today for your wonderful invitation for us to each remember that we carry that light. Sometimes we show up in interesting disguises, but we are all the manifestation of God. So we're glad you're here today. You also received a packet of information on your first visit, and you'll find inside a little slip of paper that we invite you to fill out if you're willing to do so. And after service, you can go down to our courtyard area, down the stairs through the entryway, and that slip of paper filled out gets you a free brunch. And did you see what it is in the bulletin today? I'm going to beat you all down there because it's good food. And so we invite you to enjoy our hospitality with brunch in our courtyard and sharing and getting acquainted with all of us today. We also like to stay in touch with members of our community and this beloved community. And if you'd like to be in connection with us in that way, Reverend Tim sends out a weekly text thread to everybody who signed up. So if you would text, if you're interested, to the phone number on that very smartphone you have, to the number 808-707-7406, text the word welcome. And that puts you in the loop with Tim and his weekly announcements. Even if he's gone, he's sending out a text in church message. And if you've been around for a while but haven't decided to join, text the word loop so that you can stay in the loop of what's happening here on Sunday mornings in our services. We're glad to have you as part of our community. Leslee's been sharing with us a number of spiritual practices today. Cindy introduced our spiritual practice of prayer that we believe in firmly here in Unity. And we know that another spiritual practice that we can choose as a manifestation of divine energy is to share generously of the gifts we have. So I invite the ushers to come forward, please. And if you are called to give a gift this morning, we invite you to just be present to that call on your heart. Many of us in this community give on a consistent and regular basis. You can do that by going to our website. There are many methods by which you can consistently give. And we appreciate all that gift of love that those financial tithes represent here in our community. You lift us up. You lift the work that we are called to do in this world by your gifts, and we are grateful. So I like to bless the offering when we are about to receive with this prayer. And if you know it, say it along with me. Divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I give joyfully, gratefully, and wait for the return. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
To the front. And so we just take this time to bless this offertory, this offering, knowing that it was given from the heart, that each one of us is that giving presence of God, that lovable presence of God. And so we say thank you, God, for these gifts that go on to prosper not only our lives, this community, but the world. And so it is. Amen. And thank you, Leslee, for a beautiful sermon. A lot different than earlier this week. It had different content. So it was excellent. So thank you for blessing us with your presence and with your sermon today. And now I'd like to invite up our prayer chaplains. If you are in need of a one-minute miracle, please see our prayer chaplains in the front. They are willing and ready to hold the high watch with you. And now, as we close out today's worship service, let us stand, let us rise as we conclude today's service. The light of God surrounds us. I am the light of God. The love of God enfolds us. I am the love of God. The power of God protects us. I am the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence of God. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
I believe in the people of all nations to join and to care for.